Hey everybody, it's Norm from Tested, and I want to introduce you guys. Well, you might have known him from past videos. This is Alex Hornstein from Looking Glass Factory. How you doing, Alex?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing great, and it's always great to have you guys here in our studio. I know you're in town for Augmented World Expo, yeah. Because of course, the holographic devices and displays you guys make would be perfectly suitable for that. So you guys, if you guys don't know out there, know Looking Glass is not only the name of the company, but the name of the product that you guys launched a year ago, and that's this right here. This is the Looking Glass.
That's right. This is the Looking Glass.
You did a Kickstarter, successful, and what's the status for this? Do people have it, and what are people doing with it?
Yeah, so it's really exciting. So we started shipping these in December, and these got out into the world, and now there's thousands of these in the world, and that's kind of this creative community of everyone from game makers, animators, CAD modelers. There's this whole community of people who are creating 3D works that go in here. And now that we have this community, a lot of what we do in Looking Glass is support them. We integrate with more software. We find ways for people to get their stuff in here and make it look good. And we help distribute that. So we start seeing stuff that people I've never met have made that is in the Looking Glass. And I'm really, and not just a couple things, like every week there's more and more submissions that come through, and we distribute those through this software we call the library.
Mm. And so it's a combination of just captured stuff and also rendered objects and just different things that you had no idea that people would be creating for this display, for this light field display.
That's right. Like we've seen everything from storytelling, where people are making animated shorts that play in here. I saw the first person cry watching a story in here, which I didn't expect. But I was like, oh my God, like somebody emotionally connected enough with a story being told in a hologram to like, it brought them to tears. That's wild.
I mean, we so often think of, you know, the displays we have as windows into some digital world, whether it's a computer monitor or even the VR headsets that we have. But this, the form factor that you guys ended up on, it works as a window if people want to do that, but it also works as kind of a box that captures an environment. You could put like entire
like
stage.
A stage,
exactly. And are you finding people using it as how we talked about last year, where people are rendering, designing things on a connected computer and dragging it over, and this being kind of like the way to view 3D without having to put on a headset as well?
Totally. So, and sometimes it's not even a drag over. Like if someone's working in Unity or someone's working in Blender, what they see as they're designing or making an animation, that scene shows up in real time here. So let's say I'm putting lights into a scene. I might use a leap motion and move my finger around and child a light to my fingertip. Mm-hmm. So I can move it around and place it and just hit like space. That's where I want a light. That's where I want a light.
Right.
And I feel like I'm having a 3D interaction in a 3D world. It's like I'm putting it into a small stage that I'm setting up.
Yeah.
And then we also see people make really lovingly made animations and renders and scenes that don't work in real time, because these are done like very, very carefully and meticulously, but they look beautiful. Like it looks like there's a real object in here, a real scene playing out in here.
I mean, the thing that we have on here, we've got some different angles for it, is a perfect example of that, because you have the shadows are using the dimensions and the kind of the frame aspect of the device to then cast the shadows in the right place. So it looks like there's a goldfish swimming
right.
around. And not only is it interactive, what I love is that it's shared and communal, right? You can pull people over and we're together within the field of view of this, seeing the same 3D object.
Yeah, I mean, this one's by Kajiro Takahashi, who works at Unity in Japan. And he puts out these amazing open source projects that are visually stunning and kind of on the very cutting edge of what you can do in 3D. Mm. And so this was one of our, we looked at this in the Looking Glass, like, oh my God, it feels like it's here.
Yeah.
It's wild.
I can't wait to other people do with it. But you're here to show off something new. So at Augmented World Expo, you guys are unveiling a new product. That's this here. What's different about this device?
That's right. So this is the Pro. And the Pro, and the Pro is, if you look at this, this is really a creator system. We designed it because creators have their own laptops, they have their own hardware that they like to work on. And we said, we don't want to fight that. We want to work with whatever you've got. This looks like a monitor, plugs in over USB and HDMI, and you work on your own laptop. But you have this whole setup whenever you plug it in. It's hard to take around. It's hard to just like plug in a wire and have it do the thing. And so this is the first system that is really integrated into one unit. It's an all-in-one setup.
So the computer is in there, in behind the frame, behind the glass. You have this secondary display, which looks like it's a way to interact with Windows and load up animations. Is that touchscreen as well?
Yes, so both these are touchscreens.
This is touchscreen. Previously, there were things like you plugged in
Leap Motion.
Right, and that's now integrated.
Yeah, so in this case, this is a touchscreen that lets me do kind of the gestures we're used to on a 2D interface like a phone, where I can do pinch to zoom, I can drag things around, I can do kind of your basic translate, rotate, scale. It's how everyone is very accustomed to working with 3D environments on a phone.
It's built into the bezel on the
bottom? Built into the bezel.
Got it.
And this is just a traditional screen with a touchscreen on top. But that lets me do, again, like things, so this was a demo that we built with some partners called OrthoScience, and this one lets me switch from here's a patient's mouth without where teeth are crooked, here's what that looks like corrected, and going from kind of an info-dense 2D display and bringing up a particular scene in 3D that correlates with that.
Yeah. Show me in the design of a Mobius strip, inverted. Is
that that's right.
The endgame reference. Yeah. That's super cool. And having this interface, then the gates having a laptop interface, mouse interface, and you're building things that are framed for this aspect ratio as menus.
Yeah, that's right. So this is more for, you're going to build a single application on here, and you want to deploy it to here. So you want something, this is just going to stand alone and play that one application over and over and over. If you want to develop, you pull up your laptop, you plug in your HDMI from your laptop, and it automatically detects, oh, something else is connected here. And it just acts like a second screen, so you can develop on your own machine, and then you make a build, put it on here, and it's ready to go.
What type of compute are you putting in here, and what's necessary to run all those views for your light field?
Yeah, so it's the guts of a gaming PC. So inside, there's an Intel SuperNUC, and it's very, very similar to the guts of this like kind of mid-range gaming laptop. So it's between like NVIDIA 1050, 1060 graphics card. Mm-hmm. And that was just from a lot of testing of seeing, looking at frame rate, looking at capability on the apps we have right now and saying, okay, this is going to do a good job running a broad spectrum of apps.
If you want your Unity Live view, and of course, if you want your pre-rendered stuff, that's going to be fine to split up those views and join them up. So what other things have you guys experimented on this? You know, obviously there's the pre-rendered stuff with this, like, this is right. nicely pre-rendered. What's the state of, like, light field, like, video?
Yeah. So we've been doing some work with a partner called Kendo, which is really, really interesting. So they've been building some really fascinating 3D capture software and cameras. And one of theirs that we thought was kind of an amazing fit in Looking Glass universe is this this camera they built that is what's called a 3D 360 camera. And so that, in this case, here's somebody looking at a reindeer farm. Mm-hmm. But what this does is this captures a full 360 view with a depth map. So that lets me take that 3D world that this camera saw, and this is a still image this camera saw, but it lets me pull it in here, lets me zoom through,
And the parallax gets retained, even though you're kind of changing your focus, your telephoto distance.
That's right. And similarly, like look, that same idea works on 3D scenes. So on 3D video, rather. So this one is the same idea, but shot in video. So this is lets you take record videos, pull it out, and from us. We saw this camera was originally developed for a VR pipeline. It was meant to stream to people and so they could look around in a headset.
And be comfortable with some little bit of lateral movement, right?
A little bit of lateral movement.
Yeah, because if you have 360 video or 180 stereo video, it looks 3D, but any type of kind of movement like this doesn't translate.
Yeah, it starts to break. And so we saw that and we're like, oh, this actually, there's this content out there. There's ways that people are filming and producing and broadcasting that content. And it works great in VR. It also, we can pull it into here. Mm. And so that was one of these kind of neat interplays between the two areas.
I mean, the best kind of pop culture analogy would be like the Film Minority Report, where like Tom Cruise in there and he pulls up that vacation footage and you have basically flat video that's overlaid on top of geometry.
That's right.
And filling on the sides. And this is kind of like the first steps toward that. They have to fill in a little bit of the sides, you know, but it allows for comfortable viewing across different angles.
That's right. It's exactly right. And it's, I feel like Minority Report, it's always one of the pegs we have of like, oh yeah, like that's actually tech that exists right now. And they're just framing it as here's what it's going to look like in the future.
Yeah.
At least the capture tech. We didn't have those hologram displays.
Yeah. So that's the current version of Looking Glass Pro for holographic displays. Is this going to be another Kickstarter? Is it something that people can just buy and order?
You can just buy it. So the deal is, this is it's going on sale at AWE, and really it's this with a computer as an all-in-one setup. So for display applications, if this is going to go into a business, if this is going to go in at like enterprise application, this is the easiest thing to deploy. And yeah, going on sale this weekend.
That's very cool. What's next for Looking Glass? I mean, you guys are always thinking ahead. You guys have iterated a holographic display for so long. You know, last time when Sean was here, I asked him, like, could this scale up and be big? And you know, what does it take to get more views and a wider viewing angle or higher resolution? You guys still experimenting and prototyping in that?
We always are. So one of the things people always ask is like, how big can it get?
Yeah.
And so the first thing we did is we worked out some software. So we said, like, okay, let's say we built a way in our SDK to tile across Looking Glasses. And that lets us build, just by taking like multiple ones of these, we can build little Looking Glass display walls. And they have a seam inside. But that lets us start to experiment and show and talk to interested partners and say, all right, here's what this looks like if it's a 2x2 array. And if people say, that's great, how do you get rid of the block? We say, well, let's look at making that. And those are things that we are working on all the time. And similarly, looking at different ways of capturing light fields, different ways of displaying information. How do I capture 3D info with my phone? Like, almost all new phones have some type of stereo camera in the back that captures depth information. That's amazing that I can capture a shot and have it in here in a second. Like, that's a wild thing.
Right.
The front-facing camera on this phone, for example, lets me shoot video, like depth video. That's amazing. So there's lots of ways that are, there's lots of things that are on the cusp where there's existing technology that has 3D sensors and 3D capability, and we're working on ways to integrate that in here for communication, for entertainment, and for work. And all these are really kind of wonderful to play with. It's these new areas that are coming up that we love.
And as you said, you can also piggyback on development and investment in AR and VR, and that content now can also work here, except it's outside of a headset.
Yeah, it's amazing. Like, there's a lot, there's kind of this wave of work around 3D in all kinds of things. Like, phones shoot with stereo cameras because they can artificially blur the background and make pictures look crisper and nicer. It just so happens that because all phones do this, we also have a way that all phones capture 3D info that we can use.
Yeah.
And so these are areas that I think are really compelling. Like, anywhere where there's like this big cluster of people working from different angles on 3D, it's a really wonderful place to play because there's stuff that happens that we didn't make happen, but that we can work with.
It really is the type of device that I know you guys are watching it through, you know, the lens of a 2D video, but that when you see it in person, you just get immediately. And I hope that people out there have a chance to see the Looking Glass in person, because you have kids run up to it and interact with it, and it's intuitive because it is how you perceive light field or how you perceive the real world.
That's right. That's what we hope for, is just playing with how people see the real world and making something that feels like it's on the table in front of you, making like a bringing of impossible universe into the room with you.
Well, awesome. Thank you so much, Alex, for coming by and giving us a preview of this. I'll have more information on these products in the description below, and more coverage of tech like this in the future. Until then, we'll see you next time you visit.
Yeah, sounds great. I can't wait.